Albert Granda here, pizzatherapy.com. I have my old friend, Scott Wiener, on the line. We're talking pizza. And I told Scott, let's kind of narrow the focus a little bit. I want to talk about New York slices. Honestly, something I don't know a whole lot about, although I've had slices in New York. Recently, Scott, in this issue of Pizza Today, he wrote a column about the rebirth of the New York slice. So what is a New York slice, Scott?
Great question, because I think a lot of people try to define it differently when they're in places that don't have the architecture of New York City. And by that, I mean like the layout of the city. Like a New York slice is a portable, thin in the center, gently puffed on the ridge. It's a 1/8 of an 18 to 22 inch diameter pizza low moisture mozzarella and a lightly seasoned, if it's seasoned at all, tomato sauce. It's very simple. It's very elegant. There's not much going on. But I'll tell you, Albert, one thing that needs to happen is it needs to be larger than the paper plate that it's served on.
Okay.
That's a New York slice.
All right. So I didn't realize the parameters were kind of narrow for what makes a New York slice.
Well, I feel like it's, I don't know. I feel like even that is, I gave kind of a broad definition. I don't care what kind of oven you use. I don't care what brand of anything you use. I don't care what kind of flour. It's just, you know, it has to fit that description. You know, if it's a puffy, thick pizza, that's not a New York slice.
Yep. Now, let me get into some controversy, my friend. You know, New York has been known for the 99-cent slice. I mean, is that a New York slice or is that blasphemy or what? What's going on?
It is absolutely a New York slice. It's just that we've become known for that over the past maybe 12 years.
Yep.
And because it's become a new-ish format, because they're on corners, they're in really popular areas, and the idea is that you make like thinner margin, but that you're pushing a lot of volume. And so that is it's what I would call, and it's hard to say this without saying, like, I don't mean any offense, but it's a lower quality New York slice.
Yeah, let's call it. Yeah.
Because you know, you pay in a dollar. You can't assume it's going to be the same product that you'd get for $2.75 or $3.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. And then there are slices. I mean, I've been to DeFara, Don DeMarco's. His slices are, when I was there, $5. And maybe it's even more now. I mean, so we're talking pushing the envelope there. I mean, you can have some really high quality slices. I know Paulie G has a slice shop. His slices are just fantastic. What are some of your favorite pizza slices that you've found in New York?
There's a lot. There's starting off with the quintessential Joe's and New York Pizza Suprema. Those are like the quintessential definition of the New York slice. But then Patsy's in Harlem does a slice, but that's different because it's coal-fired. And it's very rare to find these coal-fired New York slice shops, especially the older ones. So Patsy's is like an outlier. I can't say that in the same sentence as the others quite so easily. And then you get to the dollar slices that you talked about, which I'm admittedly not a huge fan of. But then you get this revival, the kind of, I don't want to say upscale, but they're more expensive because they're using better quality ingredients.
Sure.
And they're putting in a little bit more care and a little bit more attention. Not that Joe's is not cared for, but Joe's is like a system. It's like they've been banging out the same pies for decades. But these other places, Lindistry, Scars, Upside, they're all making a higher quality version and you're paying more for it. But
we call them artisan slices then. Artisan slices.
Sure. I mean, it's a New York slice. But see, the problem is when you go to Scars and you get that slice, it's not really an artisan slice because, I mean, you're eating the pizza. It looks like just a real good New York style pizza.
Yeah.
Nothing about it. There's no, what do you call them? Like when you put a little edible flowers on them. It's not like that.
Right, you know? right.
It's not artisan like, oh, I'm belaboring. Same thing with Lindistry. It's like, it's just the current interpretation of what a New York slice shop can be.
Right. Now on your tours, I've been on the tour, which I love, and we're not eating a whole pie. We're having a slice. So how does that work?
Yeah, the way it works is the New York slice is served by the slice. You could order a whole pie, but sure, the idea is you walk up, you get a slice, it's reheated or it's fresh. Yep. You walk out with a paper plate. So on the tour, every stop we do, you're eating a single slice.
Right. Stop. Right. From Lombardi's to wherever.
Yeah. Even though like Lombardi's doesn't sell it by the slice, nor does John's.
Yeah.
But we go with a group. Everybody eats a slice.
Yeah.
We continue.
Yeah. 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 So in your article, you talk about the revival of the New York slice. And so you mentioned Scars. He seems like an amazing pizza guy. He has a great story.
He has been working in pizza. I mean, he grew up in the city, been working in pizzerias for a long time. And I had not met him or heard of him until I found out that his place was going to open. And one of his childhood friends, who's now a manager of his pizzeria, this guy Yanni, was working at another pizzeria that I was going to all the time. And he said, oh yeah, my friend's opening this place. And I went by and I was like, this place looks amazing. It looked like a throwback, like 1980s New York slice shop. And yeah. But I'd never met the guy. But it turns out he's like, he worked in all the, like Lasso, Lombardi, I think he was at Joe's. I mean, he was at all those places. And he decided to, let me do this my way and do it organic ingredients when possible, house milled flour whenever possible, like all this really good stuff.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So really taking the whole slice concept to a whole nother level.
And yeah, it's just, you know what it was, Albert? It was like back in the day, the ingredients were, the availability was lower. So you don't have many options 30 years ago. Now you got all these options. And suddenly we can like, yeah, you can do this like heirloom grain if you want, or you can mill your own flour like Scar's doing.
Wow.
Now you have the option. It just, I don't want to say that that you couldn't have done that 30 years ago, but it was definitely a lot harder to do it. Like even Italian, some people are using Italian flour, whether or not you like that, doesn't matter. It's, you couldn't do that 30 years ago. Nobody was really importing that much flour.
Oh, okay. Okay. And how about the toppings, the topping ingredients, the sauce and the cheese? A little bit different?
Yeah, the sauce has always been really simple. Like most places are doing an uncooked tomato and salt. That's it, raw.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Not cooked sauce of any sort. And the cheese has just been low moisture or part skim or whole milk, low moisture mozzarella, shredded. That's it. Maybe some places cube it. That's it.
Oh, okay. Great. Great. And on the tour, where are you? You said you're starting your second tour tomorrow. Where are we going? Where are you going to go?
Tomorrow's tour, it's a private tour. So don't tell them where they're going to go because it's going to be a secret.
Okay.
We're going to start at John's and talk about the history. And then we're going to move on to probably Song in Napoli, which is a Neapolitan place.
Yep.
Then I'm thinking we're going to loop back to go to Joe's. And then there's a possibility maybe we go to Zazie's after that, which is like one of these newer elevated slice kind of places. I don't know. Emily is in the neighborhood, so we might go there.
Yep. Okay. So
tons of options.
It's wide open. It's kind of a blank canvas for the tour.
Ben's is a good Sicilian. So I you know, when I meet the group on the tour, that's when I make the decisions.
Oh, no kidding. Okay.
Yeah, if I feel like this is not the group to take the Benz, I'm not going to take them to Benz. But if I think like, this group would benefit from Benz, then I'll take them to Benz.
Yep. And all your groups are really different. I mean, you get a different, kind of a different personality in the group, who's in the group. You know, maybe they're pizza aficionados, maybe they're first timers. Interesting.
You never know. I mean, like a lot of everybody lately has been local. So when it's local, you got to be on your toes because they've already been all these places or some of them. So I got to take them to places that are surprising or that are ones that they didn't realize the thing on the menu that they should try.
Yep. Yeah.
You know, I want to give them access. So when you go to a pizzeria by yourself, you're a customer, but when you go with the tour, then you're really part of their team and getting access.
Oh yeah. You get the, well, you get the inside back of the house kind of story when you go in with you, I mean, which is pretty amazing, I think.
Yeah, so I mean, that's great. The stuff that we love.
Yeah, that's what we love. That's what we love. Scott, just saw you the other day in a video called Pizza, A Love Story, which I thought was fantastic.
Oh, yeah, the New Haven, documentary.
Thing. Yeah, yeah. Tommy Iannucci and I reviewed it. Just fantastic. You had a lot of great stuff to say about New Haven and about New Haven pizza in general. It was fun seeing you. I thought that was great.
Thanks. I was so honored to be a part of that. The team that put it together was so great, and you could tell that they really have a deep love for New Haven.
Yeah, they did a really good job, I have to say that. Lately, you've been going from pizza tour guide to pizza master. You've been teaching classes. Tell me a little bit about that.
Certainly not a master, just a professional.
No, right. Okay. I'm sorry.
You know,
pizza wannabe. No, nobody's a master. Okay.
Well, you know what it is? I've been making pizza for years. And actually, I think yesterday was the anniversary of the first time I ever made a really great pizza that I was proud of.
Oh, cool. Oh, that's
11
cool.
years ago yesterday.
Yep. Yep.
And I remember, you know, I would make pizza, but it would be, okay, I would make pizza a bunch of times in a week and then not for another 4 or 5 weeks because I was busy with the tours.
Sure.
With COVID, I'm home all the time. I'm teaching pizza making classes. So I'm getting into a routine, and the best way to get better at anything is repetition.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. I've kind of like honed my recipe way better than it was before. And I'm sure it'll be way better 6 months from now with, if I stay on it. But I've been really happy with the pizza I've been making. You know what? I feel like you have to copy other pizza and then figure out what you like about it.
Sure.
And then you can kind of figure out what is the one that's for you. Like, Albert, you play music, don't you?
No. You used to many years
ago. You're a music fan.
I'm a music fan.
I know you're a music nut.
Yeah.
So when I first learned how to play guitar, I would put on, you know, an album of a band I liked, and I would figure out their songs.
Sure.
And I feel like that's what it is with pizza. It's like, oh, can I figure out what's the Joe's pizza and what's the John's pizza?
Sure.
Can I
mimic
that at home? And then you're like, oh, I'm going to take that chord change that I really like how that feels, and I'm going to write a song that has this similar vibe to it. Same thing with pizza making, where it's like, I'm going to stretch it that way because I feel like that gives me the right texture that I like. And I'm not going to cheese it the way that they do. I'm going to cheese it the way they do.
Sure. So give me your 4 or 5 favorite pizza tips that you would give to someone wanting to make pizza or how to make their pizza better.
Oh, wow. It's funny because I've been writing a blog post about this for like a month and I just never finish it. Number one is use a pizza stone or a baking steel.
Or baking steel. Yep. Something.
Just something that gets hot.
Yep.
Number two, if you're going to do something that gets really hot, you have to use a pizza peel to get the pizza onto the thing. And for that, I'd recommend a wooden peel, not a metal peel, but use a wooden peel. That's number two there. And then number three is don't mess with the dough until you're ready to stretch it. Let your dough relax, give it plenty of time, a day, 2 days, 3 days, and then don't squeeze it. When you stretch it, cover it in flour, then start to mess with it. Fourth tip would be careful with your topping quantity, because over topping the pizza is a sure way.
Yeah, there you go. Less is more. Yeah, absolutely. Definitely. That's those are four great tips. Scott, resuming the pizza tours. Are we going to be back up very soon?
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Yeah. Private tours are going right now, and public tours restart Pizza Margarita Day, June 11th.
Okay. Wow. All right. That sounds fantastic. And Scott, you're still going to be making pizza on the sly in your home?
I will be teaching private pizza making classes. I was doing public ones on the weekends, but I have to phase them out so I can go back to tours. But I'll be doing private weeknights, mostly some weekend nights. And maybe even some in-person classes, but you know, on a small scale. That's not my focus of what I want to do.
Sure, of course.
But I enjoy doing it. It's really fun. I love teaching.
Oh yeah, I know you do. No, and I think also when you teach, you master the skill as much as your students. I mean, that is the ultimate way to learn, I think.
Yeah. Now, when you teach, Albert, what's the most common thing that comes up in your classes that you see people doing that's the big mistake?
Oh, good question. Good question. I would have to say when I'm teaching pizza, it definitely would be over topping. And, you know, when I teach, you know, it's in a group setting with kids that haven't made pizza before, although I have enough of them that some have some experience, I'm always in control because the first couple of times I did a class, I let the kids just go wild and it was a huge mistake. So I'm in control every step of the way. Gentle reminders. I mean, I'm not losing my temper or anything, but within limits. And I think it's real important for them to understand pizza is an art. Pizza is a wonderful thing to make. And you just can't mess with it. I mean, you can't throw everything that you want to, including the kitchen sink, on pizza. So I would say that's, you know, holding kids back a bit is real important. When you're dealing with teenagers, they tend to get a little bit out of control.
Yeah, I get that. I mean, it's pizza. Yeah. It's exciting. Everybody
it's exciting. That, definitely. Definitely. Hey, Scott, how can people contact you? How can they sign up for your tours?
Let's I'm put very in a easy plug. To find. Yeah, it's just scottspizzatours.com or on Instagram at scottspizzatours. That's it.
Okay, great. Scott, first of many conversations, I'll be talking to you again soon. Thanks so much for hanging out with me.
Oh, it was my pleasure. Thanks. Good to see you, Albert.
Yeah, good to see you.